Everybody, my name is Julia Mahoney. I am the Educational Program Administrator for Renew Theaters, and I want to welcome everyone tonight, but I do want to give a special shout out to our members from the Ambler, the County, the Prince Garden, and the Highway, as well as members from the Majestic in Gettysburg, who is partnering with us for this program. Ooh. And programs like this are possible due to the VESTA Fund, which has given us a grant for our online seminar series, Deep Focus. Now, tonight, we will be discussing the film, The Earrings of Madame De, led by Alan Amtzis. But before we begin to discuss, I do want to mention a couple of other events that we have coming up this month. Next Tuesday, we will have a talk on two Pedro Almodovar films, his most recent work, Parallel Mothers, as well as his 1987 film, The Law of Desire. On the 15th, we will have Hannah Jack back for our classic Hollywood series, leading a talk on Sidney Poitier movie, A Patch of Blue, which you can watch in person at the County Theater tomorrow evening and at the Ambler and Princeton Garden Theaters this Thursday evening. Finally, on the 22nd, our Asian American film series will make its return with Wong Kar-wai's In the Mood for Love, which we will also be playing at the Ambler, County, and Princeton Garden earlier that week. Now, I do know that was a lot of information I just threw at everybody. So I just want to say that you can find more information on those and any other upcoming talks on our website, deepfocus.film.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Do you know, I have not been able to find Parallel Mothers to stream. Is it only in the movie theater or can you stream it?
Yeah, it's only in movie theaters right now because it was just recently released. Okay. Good question. Before I turn things over to Alan, I do want to do a quick reminder of Zoom protocols. So I do request that everybody remains on mute unless they're actively speaking. Just because we have a decently sized group here, I don't want us talking over each other. We will begin with a talk led by Alan and then open it up to a larger discussion. We ask that if you have a question or comment that you please use the raised hand feature, which is found in the menu at the bottom of your screen, and I will call on speakers. Also, feel free to use the chat feature for anything related to the film. We'll bring anything interesting in from the chat feature into our discussion as well. Alrighty, now time to introduce our guest. Alan Amtzis is a director of the Masters of Education Instruction Program at the College of New Jersey, where he also teaches a course called Terms of Enqueerment, a History of LGBTQ Film and Media. He holds a master's degree in film studies from Columbia University, where he wrote his thesis on Max Ophüls' The Earrings of Madame De. His lifelong love of movies began at age 5 when he saw his first film in a movie theater, Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho. Prior to becoming an educator, he worked as a script reader and as a casting director for films, music videos, and commercials. He appeared briefly as a featured extra in the costume party scene of Jonathan Demme's 1993 Philadelphia as The Pope. But don't blink or you'll miss his moment. He is also a proud member of the County Theater. And with that, I turn it over to you, Alan.
Thank you, Julia. And thank you, all of you, for coming and giving me a chance to share a little bit about this movie that that I love and has meant so much to me. So thank you all for coming out on this sort of random Tuesday, the first day of February, the first day of Black History Month, the eve of Groundhog's Day. And our movie, of course, has nothing to do with any of that. But it's interesting, about 10 minutes before this event started, I thought, oh my God, I've got all these people coming and I'm gonna talk to them about Max Ophüls technique and filming techniques and film history and things like, you know, the metaphoric implications of staircases. And by the way, there are over 60 staircases in this film, people going up, people going down, people going across. I say about 60 because I always try to count them and I always get lost somewhere around 60. I'm also gonna talk a little bit about the moving camera. I'm gonna talk about mirrors and windows. Max Ophüls' original design for this film was that it would be seen, everything would be seen through mirrors and windows and through curtains, that there'd be absolutely no direct focus on people. He sort of got rid of that idea. It seemed a little impractical after a while, but all of those elements remain. And I thought, why am I going to talk to everybody about these incredibly academic aspects of this film? If you've seen the film recently for the first time, or if you haven't seen it in a long time, it's very likely you didn't quite notice the moving camera or the staircases or the mirrors. What you should have noticed, or felt rather, I hope, was a sense of grace, a sense of elegance, a sense of urgency, and a sense of drama. So we'll save all of that emotional reality for our group discussion, because I do want to talk to you a little bit about where this movie fits sort of in film history, and where Ophüls fits as a filmmaker. And to do that, I have to tell you just a little bit about myself. Julia's already given you a slight introduction. But before we begin, I kind of want to set the mood. So I'm going to play for you just a minute of the opening music, which maybe you remember, maybe you don't. You certainly hear the three major themes enough time throughout the movie. There's Madame De's theme herself. There's a theme for when she's with Donati. And most importantly, there's a theme for the earrings themselves. There's one particular piece of music that we hear every single time we see the earrings, with one exception. And again, if you've seen the film, when she stages her little ruse about finding the supposedly lost earrings, and she dumps them out of her glove, it's the only time in the entire movie where there's no sound at all. But just to get us in the mood for this very lush, romantic epic, I thought we'd just hear a little bit of the opening music.
Anybody hearing it that well? Seems distorted to me.
It goes up and down quite a bit. Sometimes it comes in, sometimes it stops.
Was that not audible? I heard somebody say, does anyone hear anything?
It's going in and out a little bit.
Oh, well, I'm sorry about that. Well, hopefully what you did hear sounded lush and romantic. But we'll proceed. So I want to just tell you a little bit about how this movie came to me and how this movie comes to us, because I think how we come to movies, the important movies of our life, is important. As you already heard from Julia, I saw my first movie in a theater at age 5. It was Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho. I saw it on a Saturday at the local Allerton Theater in the Bronx. My sister, who was 10 years older than me, was charged with babysitting me, and all her friends were going to the movies. And so she thought, well, I'll just drag him along. And when I tell people that Psycho was my first film at age 5, people often say, oh my God. And then I ask if I'm afraid of showers. And the truth is, I'm not afraid of showers. I am afraid of motels, however. But what that experience did for me was that it started my lifelong love of the movies. And I don't even really know why. I don't know what it was about being in a dark room, watching a series of pictures on a big screen, and having this intensely private emotional experience in a theater full of strangers. I don't know why that was attractive to me, but I think it has something to do with the larger than life fantasy world on the screen, very much like a dream, or in the case of Psycho, a nightmare. I also grew up in New York City in the 60s and 70s, and that meant that I had the opportunity to see hundreds and maybe even thousands of movies, not just the contemporary Hollywood releases and the international classics, but a lot of old films at repertory theaters like The Thalia, The Elgin, The Regency, The 80 St. Mark's, and about 10 other theaters, to see movies that I had only heard about in books. So I grew up at the movies. From the time I was about 9, I went to the movies almost every single weekend of my life. And in my early 20s, I went to film school at Columbia. And as a master's student there in the film studies program, I was expected to write a master's thesis. And I had a lot of great ideas. Soviet socialist realism was a possibility, Italian neorealism, the German new wave of the 70s, which was very current and very sexy at the time, particularly the work of Rainer Werner Fassbinder. And then I met Max Ophüls and everything was swept aside. I spent about a year seeing as many of his 27 films as I could find, a few of his early German and French films, his four Hollywood films, and the final four French films, which sort of form a sort of spectacle of magnificence. Out of all those films, though, The Earrings of Madame de really emerged as the most iconic. I wrote my thesis on it, and I saw it at least 30 times that year. So I struggle a bit to talk about it academically, because for me, and I hope for all of you, it's primarily an emotional experience that has something to do with longing, with romance, with fate, with the 19th century, and mostly with a vision of what cinema is or could be, or what cinema does for us. Every time I see this film, I get caught up in a sort of dizzying, swirling spiral of emotions, storytelling, and a sense of what I want movies to be. And I hope that all of you, or at least most of you, understand that what I'm trying to say here about this story of a rather flirtatious, almost silly, aristocratic woman whose world spirals around her because of those earrings that literally and metaphorically keep returning to her at several times during the narrative of this film, as her life becomes more weighty and dramatic with each cycle. I hope you also notice that Ophüls' filmmaking, noted for its moving camera work and its character movement, both serve to heighten this story into a sort of metaphysical allegory about romance. But let's look closely at Ophüls' life and work and Madame de before we open up the evening to discussion. And to do that, I'm gonna share a PowerPoint that I've created for you. So give me just a second. There. And you should be seeing a nice slide of the film. Is that what people are seeing? Can somebody give me a thumbs up? Great, yeah. Thank you. Okay, so who was Max Ophüls? He was born in the Saar or the Saarbrücken, a region of Alsace that's right on the border between France and Germany, literally on the border. And it's a land that exchanged nationality several times, including during his childhood and his lifetime. He was born in 1902 in the Saar, and he died in 1957. And for those of you that are lovers of Paris, he is in fact buried at the Père Lachaise Cemetery. There's a shot of his crypt. But what happened in the 55 years in between that made him somebody we still talk about today? Well, he was born as Max Oppenheimer in 1902, and he changed his name as a young man to Ophüls because he was an actor, and he thought his family might be a little bit disgraced by having an actor in the family. Eventually, though, he moved into filmmaking, directing, and he made 27 films in four countries, France, Germany, Italy, and the United States. He left Germany for France in 1933 and made about 18 films there, then moved to Switzerland, Italy, Portugal, sort of following the Jewish migration. And in 1941, he was finally able to emigrate, to escape to the United States. And he arrived in Hollywood without any idea what to do. I mean, he had already by that time made 19 films, but Preston Sturges, the sort of classic screwball comedy, golden period of American filmmaking director, had seen a few of his films and really admired them. And he sort of mentored Preston Sturges, sort of helped him get on the board at some of the major studios. So why was he important? What happened in between, and what are some of the career highlights? One of the things to understand, the way to understand is to look at the film world that grew up around him, that began roughly in his infancy. Many of you know, probably most of you know, that Edison invented the motion picture camera in 1988. And almost immediately, the filmmaking world split into two, divided by how people saw the purpose and possibility of the nature of motion picture. And those two worlds were reality and fantasy. The Lumiere brothers in Paris represented reality, almost in slavish devotion to the details of daily living, including films from about 1895 to about 1902 when Ophüls was born, that chronicled such daily events as a train entering a Paris railroad station or workers leaving the factory after a hard day of work. This is what motion pictures looked like. And then in 1902 came Georges Méliès, who's basically known as the magician of the movies. His movies were hand-tinted flights of great fantasy. He had no interest in reality. Everything in his movies was handcrafted and sprang from a very forward-thinking imagination. His most famous and fabulous film, I think, is the 28-minute A Trip to the Moon, which generated some early 20th century iconic movie images, including that shot of the movie there with the bullet in its eyes. That's that's the spaceship that lands on the moon. A Trip to the Moon premiered in 1902, the year that Max Ophüls was born. And for more about the extraordinary and sometimes breathtaking career and heartbreaking career, actually, of Georges Méliès, I hope some of you have a chance to see Martin Scorsese's incredible movie, Hugo, which is a very loving and dramatic tribute to the myth and magic of Georges Méliès and the movies. Around that time, as Ophüls is growing up, D.W. Griffith emerged as the first real auteur of the cinema, the first real director with a personality stamp. So shortly after the film world began in Paris, Griffith, you know, got the movies off to a really strong start as an art form. And movies began to embrace more complex and lengthy narratives, sometimes 2 and 3 hours long, with a strong emphasis on emotional impact, political implications, and artistic dimensions. But again, the film world split immediately into sort of two possibilities. The language of film narrative was being developed just about that time. And in many ways, early American filmmakers like D.W. Griffith and Edwin S. Porter invented the first directorial ways to tell a story by the use of editing. The process, by editing, I'm referring to the process of cutting up a film into shots and pieces and narratively sequenced events like little mosaic pieces that chronicle the chronologic events of a film story. Sometimes this was done through the technique of cross-cutting or through changing the landscape of a shot from close-up to medium or to wide-angle shot. And Griffith became the first acknowledged master of using framing and editing to tell a parallel story. You see there in the middle of the screen, the sisters, Dorothy and Lillian Gish, who in this still is from Orphans of the Storm, which is a story that takes place during the French Revolution about two sisters who are separated at birth. One grows up very rich and aristocratic. The other grows up poor and a street urchin. But since it's the French Revolution, you can probably guess that two parallel stories end up at the same place, which is the guillotine. So, but the idea of telling a story through editing different tiny sequences really started around there. The techniques of film editing were soon treated with almost mathematical precision by the Soviet filmmakers, the political Soviet filmmakers such as Sergei Eisenstein, Zega Vertov, Hudovkin, a group of filmmakers who believed that film narrative was a political and philosophic endeavor based on Hegelian principles of the dialectic, a three-part philosophic syllogism constructed on the idea of thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. And this aesthetic depended on the juxtaposition of thousands of tiny discrete images, again, like mosaic pieces, whose meanings were determined by what order they were placed next to each other, as in the famous Odessa step sequence in Potemkin. And what unites these two forms of editing, one bourgeois and American and steeped in story, and the other radical Soviet and tied to politics, is that the camera rarely, if ever, moved. Part of that is just purely physical. Early motion picture cameras were large, cumbersome, heavy, and difficult, if not impossible, to move easily or fluidly. Griffith, however, did manage it once in a very famous scene from his 3.5-hour 1916 epic film, Intolerance. He and his cinematographer, Billy Bitzer, assembled the first crane shot so that the audience could enjoy the spectacle of seeing what was then the largest movie set ever built up until that time. The camera moved in, up and down, but the technique was so complicated, it wasn't really used very often, except for large scale spectacles and for intimate stories, but never for intimate stories about romance. But with the rise of the studio system and the proliferation of sound came new technology, including dollies and cranes and tracks that allowed for much more fluid camera movement, left, right, forward, backward, up, down, 360 degrees around. You see some of this even in in Busby Berkeley movies of the early 1930s. But this in turn, this ability to move the camera so fluidly, changed and influenced a new form of storytelling. Not only the way stories could be told, but the actual stories themselves. So a change in the way audiences saw films was sort of ushered in by this new technology. And it changed the way audiences understood and even experienced movies or felt them. So into this context, Max Ophüls grew up, and along with hundreds of other filmmakers who contributed to the language of film, the ways in which stories could be told were changing in exactly the way he was ready to embrace. So over the 20 plus years of his career, from the early 30s to the mid 1950s, Max Ophüls became acknowledged as the master of the moving camera, using the mobility of the camera to create an emotional tension and a connection in film narrative. An aesthetic based on unusually long takes that move with characters through space, physical space, as well as interior emotional space. So now a little bit about Ophüls. He had 19 early European films made in either France, Germany, or Italy in the 30s. Two of his most famous are Libellae and La Signora di Tutti. Libellae is a very sweet, romantic epic. An interesting casting note, the leading role is a young woman who's really very sad. She's very lonely, she's very depressed. And her best friend is a woman who's rather jovial and witty. And Ophüls had cast a woman from the Comédie Française who was known for tragedy as the leading character, and a local comedienne as her witty friend. But he found out when they were on set, their actual personalities were flipped. Other than in contrast to what their public persona was. So we actually had them change roles. And in La Signora di Tutti, he uses the moving camera a lot to initiate a series of flashbacks. The whole film is structured around flashbacks of a very popular young woman remembering her life. So in 1941, he emigrated, as I said, he escaped Europe and came to the United States, and for 6 years didn't really have much to do until Preston Sturges sort of got him introduced into the Hollywood sort of system. And he made four films in America, which are of, what's interesting about watching them in sequence, from The Exile to The Reckless Moment to Letter from an Unknown Woman to Caught, is you can actually see the progression and the growth of his style as a filmmaker. One interesting thing about that is that he worked with, in the movie Caught, he worked with James Mason, and became most well known for things that I've already talked about, the moving camera. But in terms of stories, almost all of his movies are films about women in moral crisis. He seemed to really enjoy romantic melodramas about women who are placed in dangerous situations because of love. And James Mason famously wrote a little poem about Max Ophüls that circulated the Hollywood scene. And you see it here on the screen. He wrote, "A shot that does not call for tracks is agony for poor dear Max, who separated from his dolly is wrapped in deepest melancholy. Once when they took away his crane, I thought he'd never smile again." And that was the reputation that grew out of this. But Ophüls and Hollywood were not really a great match. I don't think he was very happy there. I don't think the studio bosses were very happy with him there. And so somewhere around 1950, he went back to France, where he made his last four films. And they really form a sort of a glittering jewel case of films that not only rely on camera movement, but upon deep emotional connection. Why is the moving camera so important? I think is a question we need to sort of address before we open up for discussion. The moving camera allows us to move through spaces occupied by our main characters as they move through it while we watch. It allows us to feel as if the events are unfolding before our very eyes, as though they are in the process of being created while we watch. And this is in contrast, again, to those highly edited styles of movies that feel very predetermined for us. We feel in Max Ophüls' film like we are more than just voyeurs, more than just observers. We feel the anxiety of decision-making, almost as if we could advise the characters ourselves. There is a connected continuum of space that unites with the characters' thoughts and the actions in a way that puts us into the center of their emotional spiral. So of Ophüls' four French films, the first of his four films was made in France, was La Ronde. And these four films really refine the elements that made his work so valued by other filmmakers, including many contemporary ones who we'll talk about in a second. The ability to transform stories of love, devotion, loss, and happiness through a filmmaking style that allows the narrative to play out in real time as it might if we were there, or as if it were about us. In La Ronde, we see an adaptation of a world famous Schnitzler play, Arthur Schnitzler, a Swiss playwright, a series of 10 episodes, each united by one character who links to another character in the next episode, intercut with scenes narrated by a circus master and a carousel barker, and the characters who ride around painted ponies around and around in Ophüls' version of a sort of metaphysical circle game, where everything is connected and returns cyclically to generate actions for those who seek love. Ophüls' second French film from that period is Les Plaisirs, which in some ways is a complement to La Ronde. It's based on three short stories by Guy de Maupassant, the sort of quintessential French storyteller. And the stories are all about people who act wildly out of passion and an energized search for happiness, which eludes them. But it illustrates what I like to call the natural symbolism of life, the ways in which we imbue our world, or his characters imbue their world, with meaning, and are then in turn inspired to act on the emotions that those meanings create within them. And if that sounds a bit circuitous and a bit existential, well, so is Le Plaisir and so is Ophüls. I'm gonna go out of sequence for a moment so that we can end with Madame de. His fourth French film is the one that probably brought him the most fame, and it's his only film in color. It's called Lola Montez. And it's in Lola Montez, we're treated to the life and loves and travels of a historic character, famous in Europe in the 19th century, a woman named Dolores Gilbert, a dancer who captivated the attention of Ludwig II, also known as the Mad King of Bavaria, who bestowed her with the title of La Comtesse de Lansfeld and ensconced her in a chateau and basically made her famous. The film is in some ways the culmination of Ophüls' aesthetic. It's a story about a restless woman who travels constantly, acquiring and leaving lovers of all ages and social status behind her, before ending up as a destitute circus attraction where she has to perform her own autobiography twice a day. The film literally takes place in a three-ring circus where Lola is the main attraction. Lola herself is frequently made dizzy by her own recollections, and the camera swirls around her, capturing her pinned in a 360-degree space, even when she's confined to a small coach carriage. And then there is tonight's film, The Earrings of Madame de. But first, a quick word about Ophüls' influence on contemporary filmmakers. Many of you know the films of Paul Thomas Anderson, probably most famously Magnolia. Paul Thomas Anderson has created, if you go to YouTube and you type in Paul Thomas Anderson, Max Ophüls, you'll come up with a 15-minute video that is part of one of the Criterion Collection films, in which he talks about how Ophüls' style of moving the camera was a deliberate influence on some of his films, specifically Phantom Thread and Magnolia. Some of you, I assume many of you, are familiar with Alejandro Iñárritu's Oscar-winning film Birdman, which is directly inspired by Max Ophüls and Earrings of Madame de in particular. One of the things you may have noticed, because it's impossible to not notice, is how this film is structured with unbroken long takes where the camera travels with our main characters upstairs, downstairs, in rehearsal rooms, on stage, out in the street, and sometimes into their fantasies. Iñárritu has credited Max Ophüls with the inspiration for that. Also, Yorgos Lanthimos, whose most famous film is also the Oscar winning The Favorite, a movie that uses some degree of traveling shots and moving camera, but the sense of decor and the way people relate to space is also specifically inspired by Ophüls. And there are others, people like Martin Scorsese in the film Hugo, or Goodfellas, a film you would never associate with Earrings of Madame D'Or, but Martin Scorsese's use of traveling shots and tracking shots recalls some of the scenes in Earrings of Madame D'Or, and Stanley Kubrick's Eyes Wide Shut as well. So now let's turn our attention for a close discussion of the Earrings of Madame D'Or. And what you're looking at now is a Japanese poster of the film from a film festival there. And just as a word of introduction to get us, you know, into our own conversation, I wanna let you know that the film itself is based on a short novel. I think it's only 60 pages, and it's only been published in French by Louise de Valmorin, who was sort of the doyenne of Parisian writers in the post-Colette world. She adored Max Ophüls until he made the movie Earrings of Madame D'Or, because he changed a lot of the story from her original plan, including the ending. There's not a duel in the novella, and she was a bit upset about that. But Ophüls went the way he felt he had to go. And one of the things I hope you noticed, and I have some more I want to say about the film, but I'm gonna ease up and really get into some conversation, because I think it's important for us to talk together. But one of the things I hope you noticed, even from the very beginning, is the movie begins with these three title cards, and they're just there to give us the credits of the film and information, but the sensibility of the film is already present. You know, we see these curlicue scripted letters and this beautiful curlicued frame and these, you know, satiny backgrounds. I mean, we know that we're in for an experience of great lushness, and the music tumbles forth as we see these credits. So we know that we're going to be placed into a very sensory experience as much as a two-dimensional film can be. And I was going to discuss the opening scenes, but I think I'll wait and see what comes up from our shared discussion. So I'm gonna stop sharing right now and open up. And I hope I haven't lectured you into submission. I hope you've still retained some sense of excitement about the movie, because that's what's really important. So there are lots of questions we could have, but I'd kind of like to hear from you. What are the things you remember most? What made the strongest impression on you? What did you find miraculous about this film, or not?
I love the story, Alan. I just loved the story. And it was, and how everything kept circling back to those earrings. It's at a time when, none of us can relate to that kind of female, but I'll leave it there. The story was wonderful.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad that you found so much heart in that, because I think that's what drives the story, is her transformation from a rather silly woman to someone who values love so much, as represented by a pair of earrings.
You know, I have a question about camera movement, because I'm not versed in looking at a film where I'm gonna say to you, oh, that was a handheld camera or anything like this. I have no idea about that. But what I did notice was how edited this, there wasn't a wasted movement in this film. Mm-hmm. Everything was edited to make the story move very, very quickly, even though it was a very slow time in a lot of ways. But it just moved for me. Go ahead.
It was a time where people had time, but one of the things, you shouldn't notice the editing. I mean, as I said at the very beginning, here I am going to talk about camera technique. And in a funny way, that's the last thing you should be noticing. What you should notice is how it feels to move with a character who's in sort of emotional turmoil. That's what you should feel. But just for argument's sake, I do want to point out that there are many scenes in the film where the camera isn't moving, where characters are locked in tension. Certainly her husband, the general, and her lover Donati, in all of their scenes, there's not much camera movement. There's a lot of back and forth, you know, over the shoulder shot, meant to heighten the fact that this is not a fluid moment, but a moment of static and a moment of confrontation. So you do get both of those, and hopefully that emotionally registers when you watch the film. You really shouldn't be thinking about the technique.
We do have a little question about tracking shots in the chat, Alan.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if you see, yeah.
Let's go to the video. Tracking shots are a question of morality. I've always wondered what exactly that means, but could be interesting to think about Ophüls in this film. Well, yes. I mean, Godard is certainly one of the sort of, you know, geniuses of the French New Wave. And if he's on board with tracking shots, then so am I. I don't actually see a question here, but I can certainly affirm that I agree. And thank you for bringing that to my attention.
No, it was just more of a
comment. Is there something you want to say more about it, William?
It was just sort of a quote that I always found interesting, the idea that when the camera moves, it implies a kind of a different relationship to what's happening on screen, a kind of moral relationship, although what exactly that means, I'm not sure. If I have a question, though, I was about something different. I was surprised to see De Sica, who I didn't know was an actor. I just knew him as the director of Bicycle Thieves. I looked up and I found out that he was, quite well known as an actor as well. So that's also not a question, though.
No, it's fine, though, but it still expresses a kind of meaning. And I'm not done thinking about that quote. I think the quote about tracking and morality is really kind of interesting, because I think whatever it means, Ophüls is it. And again, it's hard. Even for me, even for someone who's seen this movie as many times as I have, it's hard to pin down in concrete terms what's actually happening in this film, because I think it's somehow, like the opening music, bypasses the intellect and goes to the emotion. But as far as De Sica goes, he did act in a few films, not many, but he certainly has a startling presence in this movie. I mean, he's so aristocratic and distinguished with the gray hair and the jet black eyes and that very strong jaw. I mean, imagine how lucky to be a brilliant actor and a earth-changing director. I mean, what a career.
And I was just surprised, because, you know, I just kind of thought, oh, De Sica, he, you know, makes these salt of the earth movies, neorealist films about people on the margins of society, but he was so good in this very kind of aristocratic film that is aesthetically, you know, quite different from his one movie that I've seen in terms of its kind of meticulousness and its concern with upper class characters.
Yeah, I think you're right. That makes a really nice sort of opposition. And of course, you know, The Bicycle Thief is probably one of the most emotional moving movies I've ever seen, and I think almost anyone who's seen it feels the same way. I see there's something else in the chat. I'll go take a look. From Tim Hall, the camera use made me transgress the eternal world.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that was the right word, but
I wonder if you mean transcend, but maybe transgress.
There was a boundary crossing, like there's like. Right. You're observing a scene as an observer, sort of externally, and then the camera would kind of slowly come in, and then you kind of found yourself in the character's internal world, you know. And I think a lot of that effect was created by the camera, you know, like you were kind of observing objectively. So there's like this objective state you were in as you were just sort of taking stock of this beautifully shot scene.
Yeah.
and then you would find yourself emotionally involved, and that emotional involvement kind of tracked the camera's movement as it got closer and closer in. Like that scene when she was in the train, for example, the camera kind of slowly worked its way in, and I'm sure there were multiple times. And you know, by the time the camera was in close, you were also then emotionally engaged into her internal state.
Yeah, I think that's how the film works. I think all of that camera movement is there to do exactly what you said, to sort of bypass our intellect and engage us emotionally with her journey. And the scene, or the one of the many scenes on trains in this film, but in that particular one, she's at a moment of great despair. She's writing letters and tearing them up and throwing them out the window and really kind of distraught. Her world is sort of in crisis and she doesn't quite know what to do. And Alan, we share that with her.
Alan, I'd like to bring up, you brought up earlier the staircases. That one particular scene in the jewelry store, where the young boy is running up and down the stairs and everything, or the use of the stairs anyway. It was so, the part about when the young boy has to run for his father, get my hat, get my cane, get my this, get my that. And it was such a marvelous scene. I wish you'd talk a little bit about the use of the staircases.
Sure. How many people remember that scene? It comes fairly early in the film. It's the first time that Madame is selling the earrings. And yes, the jeweler has this young son who's probably 12 and seems to be fascinated with her. He's like staring at her constantly. In fact, even says to his father once, tell her I said hello. And he like,
yes,
want a slap. But so why do we have a scene in which this young boy is sent up and down the staircase 3 or 4 times? Get my hat, get my cane, just as you said. Every scene in this movie has at least one parallel somewhere else. One of the earliest scenes, right after Madame sort of, and her name is Louise. We never know her last name, of course. That's the title of the film. And you know, the whole issue of anonymity is something we can discuss. But one of the very earliest scenes, after she's decided it's the earrings she's going to sell, she leaves her boudoir. She goes down the stairs, then up the stairs to her nanny, her maid, then back down the stairs, then out toward the hall, then into the breakfast room, then out of the breakfast room. Throughout the film, although it's not a staircase, the early scene in the church where she enters the church to offer a prayer so that her jewelry sale will go well. And she sort of enters the church, she goes right to the saint, then she goes to buy a candle, then she goes back to the saint, then she curtsies, she leaves. The entire movie seems to be precipitated on these peregrinations, these returns, these up and down. Even in the longest sequence in the film, when she's dancing at different balls with Donati and they're swirling, they go around and around in circles. There's this constant theme, whether it's vertical on a staircase or horizontal in a wide space, of return, of you know, a sort of spiraling of fate and I think it has to do with the sort of natural rhythms of life. I mean, think about how you leave the house in the morning. How many times do you go back and get your gloves? Oh my God, where's my mask? Did I take my book? Where's my purse? I mean, I think this kind of movement through space gives us the space to really identify with the characters. Because there's no need for that little scene with that boy, except that it's very cute. But it really reinforces the fact that life is fluid, that things not only return to us, but each time they return, they have a sort of elevated meaning. Does that make sense to you? Does that feel like it sort of addresses what you're getting at?
Johan, did I see a hand from you earlier? Sorry, Alan, I didn't mean to.
I did not, but I did have a comment actually. First of all, I think what you just said makes a lot of sense, although I do think that scene with the bordering up and down was also just funny. I thought it was one of the places in the yes. the movie. Actually, there was some humor in there, so it was great. The comment I had was really around, I thought the whole movie was very captivating, and I really enjoyed the story, and it seemed to really be good until the very end. Like, the last couple of minutes to me seemed incredibly rushed. I mean, and I don't know, it's just because of the time when it was made, but to me, the ending was almost weird to me. It just kind of seemed like cut off almost. So any reason why it is, or any?
I can't speak for the screenwriters and for Ophüls. So I almost have come up with a blank on that. Anything I say would be kind of just conjecture at this point. And I don't think I know any more about that answer than anyone else in this Zoom room would. But it does, the drama does accelerate exponentially from the time that the general confronts the Baron and initiates the duel. From that point, when once he challenges him to a duel, the stakes are up. You know, we're no longer lingering and flirting and floating. Now we've collided, and the duel actually does happen rather quickly. As does Madame's attempt to buy the jewels again and donate them to the saint at the church and leave them behind as her legacy, and her race to sort of prevent the duel from happening. But on the way there, of course, she has that wonderful moment. She says, "There's no second shot," and mm-hmm. we know what that means.
Right.
And then, of course, she sort of expires there on a tree in the way that only a 19th century heroine can. She sort of, you know, is burned up for love and lost love. And, you know, that's a definite 19th century trope that doesn't necessarily translate to now. But if you don't buy into the essential transformative romanticism of the film, you got nothing. There's nothing. Mm-hmm. Nothing. So I do think, and again, as I already mentioned, that whole final scene was invented by Ophüls and his screenwriters, and is not in the novel. And the novelist was not so happy about it. I cannot tell you how the novel ends, though. I did manage to find a copy on Amazon, but it's only available in French, and my French just isn't good enough to pierce through the idiom of mid-century French dialogue. So I'm afraid I don't have an answer for you.
Fair enough. Thank you.
We've had a couple more comments in the chat, but first we'll go with Raymond, who I see.
Alan, this is fascinating. Subtlety and nuance usually get by me. So hearing you talk about the background and what I've missed makes me want to go back and watch this all over again. But the thing that isn't subtle and isn't nuanced is everyone's got a lover, and everyone knows that everyone's got a lover. And it seems like the rule that they had, because the thing kind of pushed the boundaries of appropriateness, the friends that I have who are in open relationships and they know that the other has lovers, the rule is the same. Physical relationship is one thing. Don't fall in love. Mm-hmm. And decades later, it's the same kind of rule.
That's so beautiful and so brilliant. I'm embarrassed I didn't even think of it. But yes, everyone has a lover, and it's all sort of part of the culture, and it's meant to be quiet. And she makes the transgression, to borrow a word from Tim, of overstepping the bounds. She throws all caution to the wind. She's in love with Donati and damn everyone else. In fact, at one point in the movie while they're dancing, she says, "I hate the world." You know, and how many times does she say to him, "Je ne vous aime pas, je ne vous aime pas," I don't love you, I don't love you. But she's pulled across the boundaries of decency, and she puts her husband in the most, you know, indignant position for a husband. I want to go back to the first thing you said. If any of you decide to ever go back and watch this film, you can watch as much of it or as little of it as you like, but please notice that even in the first scene where we don't see her face, we see her, we hear her voice talking about the need to choose something to sell. And she and the camera move across her bedroom. We go into her closets, her drawers, her jewelry cases. We learn an enormous amount of history about her without ever having seen her. It's not until about 4 minutes into the film when we do finally see her face, and even then it's reflected in a mirror. There's something in there about detail and the way, in her case, her external world, her clothes, her furs, her cross, her emeralds, her diamonds, define who she is. And we don't even, and when we do see her, not only is it in a mirror, but she's pulling down a black veil over her face. So there's all of this kind of tangible physical evidence of who she is. And the movie, as it darkens, you know, and her passion becomes something she can't hold in, all of those trappings become an important. She sells all her furs so she could get this one pair of earrings that I've tracked. I think the earrings go back and forth between her, her husband, Donati, and other people 23 times in the movie. Kind of a lot for an object that's just meant to be symbolic. We still have time for a few more comments, questions, appreciations. Yes, John or Jean? John. Can't hear you. You're mute. There you go.
I love the film. The first thing, well, several things. Just as watching a film, it was sort of like something easy to watch. Mm. And there was a lot of humor in a lot of the scenes. Things to repeat, the little boy, the soldiers every time the general came by, these little things like that. But what I really loved was scenes of the Paris of those days. The doors, the glass everywhere, the mirrors, the scene at the opera, the stairs at the opera. If you've been to the opera, you can imagine when you're at the opera, the people dressed up like that with the generals and the ladies of the dresses is just sort of like so typical of that period. And you feel that when you're in Paris in those places. That was just great. So I also found the end a little rushed. I found the Baron's breakup with her just so brutal. And then I found that this came back several times. The general made several comments about she enjoys being sick, equating a heartbreak with a physical mental sickness. And I said, you know, so it's again, it's a reflection of, he really highlights the frivolity of that entire period and sort of like denying the feelings. So that came across very strongly. Anyway, it was a great film. I loved it. But as far as the technical things, I'm happy I'm sitting in on this because those are things I never consider when I look at a film. Mm-hmm. I never see them. I see the story and how I feel about them. So that's interesting.
I think that's what's supposed to happen. You're supposed to feel the power of them without noticing them. But I wish I had taken notes during your comment because you hit on four really important things. I want to try and backtrack. In one of the scenes at the opera, when the general is pretending, well, no, he is looking for her earrings, but I think he knows he'll never find them. He knows that she's made up this story, but he's, you know, he's one for noblesse oblige, so he's going to go through with the motions. But there's that one lovely moment that's both funny and reinforcing of this whole idea of movement is he comes in one box, goes out another, comes out, goes in another, back and forth about six times. And each time he does, one of those operatic ushers has to get up and down and up and down and open and move over here and go over here. And finally, one of them says, that's it. I'm not doing this again. And then, of course, he comes right out and he's up again. And, you know, it's a beautiful moment of humor that also reinforces the sort of movement. She faints, I think, three or four times in this film. And it's interesting to pair that with Donati's break with her because terminating the love affair is sort of his male privilege. He can do that and she can't. Partially because, not because of society, but because she feels too deeply at this point, too much, but he doesn't. And I think her fainting, I mean, you know, women wore corsets with whale bones. I mean, sometimes fainting was just part of going to the opera. And with her, it might even be a little bit of a manipulation. I'm not quite sure.
I think there were times when she, when it was, and then there were times when it was real.
Yeah. Yeah. When she faints at the jewelers to get him to buy them, it's a ploy. Right. When she faints at the fox hunt because she sees Donati full of his horse, that's real.
Well, she's, you know, at this, at the period that this is being portrayed in, it would very much answer Freud's trope about hysterical women and that type of behavior, because that's exactly what she exhibits.
Yeah,
that she's always in somewhat of a state of hysteria because of the elements that have affected her. In the beginning, I wasn't sure how she lost or how she went into debt. It's never really clear.
No, it's never clear. It's not mentioned. She's in debt because she's in debt. You know, presumably she has spent a bit too much, but who knows?
Yeah, no, well,
deliberately not clear. I don't think, and this is, again, there's no evidence one way or another. I have no evidence, no data to stand a claim on, but I don't somehow think it's gambling debt. She doesn't strike me as a gambler. Unlike the general's girlfriend who loses everything in the
just like insanity.
It's more than sad. It's like, no, what's wrong with you? Don't do that. But we can't help her, although we feel we can. We feel we can reach out to her, but sadly we cannot. And the next time you watch it, the same thing is going to happen.
And didn't she also, I'm sorry, didn't she always play the number 13 too?
Well, yeah. that was her coach.
The coach in the car. And I mean, in order to get those earrings to keep moving, that scene was so necessary in how she lost it. So,
yes. And then the earrings end up, you know, in Donati's possession, and, you know, he sees Madame at the customs office and tries to meet her, but he can't. And then 3 days later, their carriages interlock on the road. You know, so there's a whole theme in this movie about fate. Mm-hmm. And speaking about fate, we're at the doom of 827. I know we only have 3 minutes, so I want to make sure someone who hasn't had a chance to talk maybe gets the chance. I see there's a couple of things in the chat. I have not been very diligent about the chat. I hope if I've missed something that I should have called out, please let me know.
Okay. Well, Pat has offered to help you translate the ending of the novel. She's a retired French teacher.
Oh, how wonderful. Where are you, Pat? I'm looking. Can you raise your hand? Where'd you go? And why am I not seeing you?
I think Pat's video is off at the moment, but I'm getting her email for you. So maybe we'll all reconvene. now we know the ending of the novel.
Yeah, I also, one of tonight's guests is my friend Jean, who is a native born speaker of French. And I think at some point when I next see you, Jean, I'm going to make a present to you of this.
Super. I'd love to read it.
But Pat, I will follow up with you. Thank you so much for your generous offer.
I do have a little question for you, Alan, just based on like talking about the numbers. Sure. I was wondering the importance of luck in this movie and numbers, because we have the betting, but then we also have the aunt figure who was like reading the cards all the time.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
So I was like, why is that so emphasized in this? Well,
I think on some macro, you know, metaphysical level, this movie is about fate. What's meant to happen, and how do we create our own fate, and, you know, how do we balance? And we do this, you know, not in the movies, we do this in our own life. What's the ratio of luck to empowerment? You know, what is fate? Does fate exist? Is fate the things that will happen no matter what we do? I think in this film, you're right. The Nanin, her maid, does read cards. And I love how the general is always exasperated by this, you know, her and her cards. I want to mention one thing. I want to step away from your comment for a minute, just to go back to staircases. early in the film, when the general goes home to look for her earrings, knowing full well that she wasn't wearing them, he wakes up the entire house. And we've got servants going up and down in every which way in a sort of, you know, orgy of movement. And the cook, you know, who's kind of heavy and on her way up the stairs says, you know, I was engaged to cook, not to search for earrings. And it's just this incredible explosion of life happening because Madame has told a lie. Luck and then lies, her lies in particular, really do thread throughout the narrative of this. I mean, she tells lies to Donati that he believes and then finds out were just for him. But I think that all of the numbers and the luck really has to do with fate and her transformation from a very, very vapid woman who's only concerned with her jewelry to a deeply transformed woman who cares deeply about her earrings. And I know that may seem a contradiction, but it kind of makes sense to me. We are at 8:30 and I would love to do this all night, but I think we're officially at our end. And I hope I don't need to apologize. I know I kind of maybe over-talked you into a lecture, but I hope that you found it interesting. So
very interesting.
Yeah, thank you so much, Alan. Thank you everybody for the lively discussion, but thank you especially Alan, your first talk with us. I think you picked a great film and it was a great discussion overall. So thank you so much. Have a great night, everybody.
Take care. Thank you.
Thank you.